On the 26th of June, 1979, Eon Productions dropped the 11th entry in a little film franchise you might have heard of, the James Bond series. Coming off of the heels of a critical and commercial behemoth with The Spy Who Loved Me, Moonraker found itself amidst cinematic terrain that had undergone a tectonic shift. Another little movie called Star Wars had come along in between Bond entries and changed cinema forever. More importantly for Eon, it had boosted the popularity of science fiction movies beyond anything seen before. Wanting to capitalize on this, Eon took their iconic British spy to just about the only place on Earth he hadn't been.
James Bond into space, out and beyond.
Yes, the Broccolis thought it was a good idea to launch James Bond into space. However, for as absurd and preposterous as that notion may be, the end result is actually freaking awesome. Yep, I said it. I know, many of you were probably thinking, Moonraker is great? The one with the double-taking pigeon and intergalactic laser battle? Yes, the one and only. This might be a Bond film widely considered a laughable, guilty pleasure. It might have its flaws and it might even get a grimace or two out of its defenders at certain points. But this is a Bond film that shoved the envelope forward. And not just because it went to space. Moonraker introduced a number of influential action sequences to the series, sequences that have inspired copycats not only in future Bond films, but in other action cinema as a whole. On top of that, it features Roger Moore's best Bond performance, where the actor and the filmmaking team had finally figured one another out. Interesting character work, including both a Bond woman and villain that challenged the conventions of what those roles can be, and deeper levels within its story that have received little credit in the 40 plus years since it launched into cinemas in 1979. This influence rises to the surface almost immediately following the film's opening gun barrel. And so while you might just want to go and write Moonraker off as being stupid, and look, I get it. I had my days when I thought it was the most ridiculous Bond film ever made simply because of that climactic 30 minutes. But give it a shot. You might find that Moonraker is actually one of the most important and influential films in the long-running James Bond series. Right from the jump, Moonraker goes into a freefall with a sequence that has influenced more action cinema over the 40 plus years since than you might think. After the brief customary opening sequence where the Moonraker shuttle is stolen and MI6 commissions their best man for the investigation, we meet Bond,
James Bond,
just in time for Jaws to shove him out of a plane with a parachute. And then the stunt team does it for real. That's a real plane. That's the real sky. Those are real stuntmen, real parachutes. And if that's how Moonraker is going to begin, just imagine what it might be capable of ramping up to by the time it ends. The Bond films have spent nearly 60 years innovating and paving new ground with stunt work. Serving as no exception, this freefall still remains one of the most stunning action sequences in the entire series. Even up against later films which have been able to utilize advances in CGI and VFX, advances in other technologies at both the automotive and manned level, and simply bigger movie budgets in order to similarly push the industry forward. Remember when we looked at the Halo jump in Tomorrow Never Dies and how it served as kind of the precursor to the Halo jump in Mission Impossible Fallout? Well, in many ways, this sequence planted the seed for both. It looks just as good, time period considered, remains just as riveting, and does an equally excellent job of providing the audience with pure spectacle, propelling their focus into the remainder of the film. But in order for this freefall to occur, the franchise needed to rise to the appropriate height first. In 1969, after You Only Live Twice, directed by Lewis Gilbert, who would go on to helm Moonraker, went bigger than any Bond film before it, Eon switched gears, adapting the more mature and nuanced On Her Majesty's Secret Service with a new actor, George Lazenby, playing James Bond. Unfortunately, for as great as the film is, the scenery change didn't quite work out, and Majesty's bombed at the time. Some people were bitter about Connery leaving, and some people wanted more of the same, despite each of the five previous films, as great as they are, more or less being a step-by-step escalation of the one before it. Either way, at the time, Majesty's, now regarded by many as one of the greatest Bond films of all time, did not connect. And so Eon decided to go another way with the franchise. After Lazenby infamously declined to return, they brought back Connery for an insane sum of money and made the campiest, cheesiest, grossest, and dare I say classless entry in the entire series with Diamonds Are Forever. Ugh. As a precursor to The Spy Who Loved Me and Moonraker, Diamonds Are Forever attempts in some ways to recapture the magic and success of You Only Live Twice. It's not just that they brought back Connery and Blofeld, but they tried to make the film bigger again, turning what began as an investigation into diamond smuggling into a grandiose battle on an oil rig. It doesn't really excel in the back half. Guy Hamilton didn't have the eye for spectacle that Lewis Gilbert had, and its overdose of camp, while badly executed, feels like a rough draft of elements that would be refined with Roger Moore stepping into the role afterwards. After the three films that follow Diamonds Are Forever, Live and Let Die, The Man with the Golden Gun, and The Spy Who Loved Me, Moonraker feels like the culmination of a series of ideas that the franchise was building to. The fast-paced, fast-talking flow and snappy editing of Live and Let Die informs many sequences in Moonraker. The dry menace of Scaramanga seems to have rubbed off on Drax, and, as mentioned before, the massive climax of The Spy Who Loved Me was turned up to 11, moving the action from the supertanker Liparis to a space station. As a result, when you watch these films in sequence, Moonraker feels like a climax in and of itself, the no-holds-barred finale, and the end of an era for the series. Moonraker is a film that signals the final bow for director Lewis Gilbert, screenwriter Christopher Wood, set designer Ken Adam, Bernard Lee as M, and so many others, and gives off a feeling that it could have been Roger Moore's final time in the tux as well. Indeed, after Moonraker, Moore continuously extended his option in the role on a film-to-film basis, with a corresponding furor in the press around the time each film was going into question and whether or not Moore would finally call it quits. And honestly, I wonder if maybe Moonraker should have been Roger Moore's grand finale. It's a film that perfectly understands him as an actor and understands who his James Bond is meant to be. That understanding is formed on the pages of the screenplay first, and the man we can credit for that is Christopher Wood. Wood's work on the series is no less than Fleming's Bond adapted to Roger Moore's sensibilities. Rather than transcribe the pages of the novel Moonraker, Wood takes core ideas and characters from it, throws Moore into the mix, and then crafts the rest out of balance between the two. By doing this, Wood plays to Fleming-esque notions of who James Bond is while modernizing them and never compromising Moore's performance. Subsequently, while we get to see Moore bring Fleming's coldness to his portrayal, we also get to see Bond's misogyny called out in a forward-thinking way through the interactions he has with Holly Goodhead. And Moore, in spreading his wings wider as Bond, gets to find the perfect balance between cold, Fleming-esque Bond and the charming and entertaining personality that Moore's fans expect from his Bond. Wood's previous screenplay for The Spy Who Loved Me was the product of a series of rewrites, and Wood was the last person in and had to work his magic to make that film as good as it was. And he makes an admirable effort to achieve the same thing, but it still feels like a couple of ideas needed to be refined. He wanted and needed that second go-around. Even after Moonraker, when John Glenn and Richard Maybaum took over the directing and writing reins respectively, they went more introspective. An inevitability given how Moonraker went as big as a Bond film can go, but in turn tilted the balance that Moonraker had achieved, having been able to make this juxtaposition fit like a glove. And while Wood certainly deserves credit for this, Lewis Gilbert does as well. Gilbert is one of the most impactful Bond directors. When he made You Only Live Twice, he pushed the series to the brink of sci-fi and inadvertently established several of the franchise's most lampooned hallmarks. A bad mouse suit clad villain with a facial scar, an implausibly massive futuristic lair built into a piece of landscape, the first of what would become many times where Bond was involved with satellites in space. But after Gilbert's initial stab at bringing the biggest of spectacle to Bond, Eon scaled back. And when that didn't work, they shuffled their feet for three movies before bringing Gilbert back and allowing him to further his vision of what a Bond film can be. His second entry, The Spy Who Loved Me, grounds the action, literally, by centering it on submarines and naval warfare while upping the stakes of its plot. Stromberg wants to incite nuclear annihilation of the world entire, while he creates a utopia underwater. Gilbert would have to contend with these higher stakes in addition to the rise of Star Wars when it came time to create Moonraker as a follow-up. As a result, in the process of refining the formula he had to use in his first two Bond films, the only way left to go for Gilbert was up. Like Wood, Lewis Gilbert also focused his attention on the aspects of Bond that fascinated him the most, figuring out as he went along what worked and what needed to be altered. As an added benefit, in cementing the desires of its writer and director, Moonraker Moonraker also enables Roger Moore to, again, give us his greatest performance as James Bond.
But what about The Spy Who Loved Me?
Look, Roger tends to get a lot more credit for his work in The Spy Who Loved Me and For Your Eyes Only, but in Moonraker, I find he's even better. His Bond is always touted as the one-liner-spewing, uber-intelligent, suave gentleman, and by all means, he excels at all three, but there's more to him than that. For example, when Bond is first invited to meet Drax, take note of the scene when he arrives at Drax's estate. Moore reacts in very nuanced and detailed ways to what is going on, being exceptionally observant, as any spy should be, of both his immediate surroundings, but also the finer details that surround him. It informs Bond's actions throughout his entire stay there, how he conducts his investigation, and even how he escapes death when Drax tries to murder him under the guise of a hunting accident. Something that becomes clear right away is that Roger is going to give a much more subdued performance as Bond. Keep in mind that we just watched the space shuttle get stolen in midair, followed by Jaws landing face first into a circus tent. Ugh, that is seriously some Diamonds Are Forever shit right there. And yet, holding back the absurdity with one eyebrow stopping him from undermining the film, Moore is steadfast in playing it straight. But one of the most interesting aspects of Moore's performance comes in the way that he interacts with his leading lady. Look, I'm just gonna go out here and say it. I love Dr. Holly Goodhead. She is by far one of the most underrated and unfairly maligned Bond women out of the entire series. She tends to get a bad rap, being viewed as a hollow version of the badass Bond girl personified in characters like Anya Amasova. But anyone who might dismiss her as a copycat should probably watch the film again. Goodhead is an incredibly successful character and deserves additional praise for how progressive and ahead of her time she is. Often in Bond films, even after Moonraker, the women Bond meets are written to act demure and submissive towards him from the start, as if he's just the man they've been waiting for their entire lives. For everything I love about these films, that's the one common thread in many of them that, let's just say, hasn't aged all that well. But when we're introduced to Dr. Goodhead, she immediately has no time or patience for Bond and his bullshit.
A woman?
He quips upon meeting her in Drax's laboratory, as if a woman being an accomplished scientist is a tall order.
Your powers of observation do you credit, Mr. Bond?
She sarcastically retorts, not only shutting down his misogyny, but flat out shoving it aside and moving forward with her life. It's also something to say that Goodhead is never really the damsel in distress. She gets captured about two-thirds of the way through the film, but it happens when she and Bond are both caught off guard and dazed from an intense fight against Jaws. She even helps Bond escape, and the only reason she doesn't get away herself is because their escape doesn't go quite as planned, and Bond is inadvertently free before he has the chance to return the favor. There's no moment where Goodhead's brain suddenly evaporates so that Bond can be the hero who sets things right. Throughout the entire climactic fight on the space station, Goodhead not only holds more than her own in the fisticuffs and laser gunfights, but actively uses her scientific knowledge to thwart Drax's plans and literally save the world. Beyond the direct character dynamics between Bond and Goodhead, it's also interesting on a visual storytelling level how they interact throughout the film. Take the scene in Venice where Bond spots Goodhead at the antique museum and tails her when he sees her break off from a tour group she's blending into. If you were to deepfake Daniel Craig and Eva Green into the respective actors' places, the shots into those from Casino Royale where Bond pursues Vesper. Also in Venice, this scene in Moonraker is fairly short and granted isn't as consequential to the story as its equivalent in Casino Royale. All that comes of it is Bond reconnecting with Goodhead and thankfully not the latter's demise. But it's really telling that the poster child of ridiculous, campy, unrealistic Bond films has a scene that would be directly aped 27 years later by a Bond film at its most serious and hard edge. On top of the aesthetic of the scene, Bond's dialogue with Goodhead,
"I dislike being spied on."
Don't we all?
Has a certain one-upmanship and teasing antagonism to it, played with a dynamic that hadn't really been seen in the series before, that also feels similar to Bond and Vesper's earlier scenes in Casino Royale. The movie views Goodhead as Bond's equal, rather than a prize for him to acquire at the end of the story. Like Vesper after her, Holly challenges Bond's more questionable sexist traits, and conversely, acts as the audience surrogate not only for women, but for for anyone who knows that there's more to Bond as a character than being a
sexist, misogynist dinosaur.
Those conversations became more prevalent in the series from GoldenEye onwards, but Moonraker took a lot of the first steps, further affirming how widespread its influence is. And speaking of widespread influence, let's talk about world domination. Who doesn't love Hugo Drax? Michael Lonsdale is perfectly menacing as this megalomaniacal, psychotic, genocidal billionaire, downplaying his imposing 6'1 stature by hunching over and then overcorrecting for the difference by spitting every line, whether it be a simple observation about afternoon tea or one of the greatest lines from a Bond villain.
At least I shall have the pleasure of putting you out of my misery.
With sheer venom. Drax is one of the most joyless, miserable villains in the series by design, and while some find the character wooden and stilted as a result, I think they miss how layered and deliberate the work Lonsdale is doing here really is, and I think it makes Drax one of the most impressive villains from a pure character standpoint. As Bond investigates him, the facade of a mere shuttlecraft theft falls, and Drax turns out to be a megalomaniac. Destroy the world and repopulate it with my hand-picked people, villain, that not only has become a widely lampooned cliche of the series, but even existed within it before, particularly with Carl Stromberg in The Spy Who Loved Me. Drax, on the other hand, has built his entire life from the ground up, largely operating as a legitimate businessman and technological innovator, building relationships with various world leaders and nations, having a nigh aristocratic standing with individuals such as Minister of Defense, Frederick Gray. It enables him, when he does delve into illegal activities or furthers his actual plan, not obscene wealth, but rather the murder of most humanity in order to repopulate the Earth with perfect specimens, to essentially deflect skepticism onto those investigating him because of his deep ties and friendships. Without naming specific billionaires or powerful figures, though I'm sure you could guess who, this is resonant today. It's not as if this didn't happen back in the 70s either, but in the digital internet age where misdeeds can be so much more easily uncovered, it's much more damning. And as the series has evolved, Drax has become something of a template for numerous Bond villains, rich industrialists, media moguls, investors, operating under a facade of charity and kindness, and a charismatic public figure, while they really plot to destroy Silicon Valley so as to monopolize the microchip industry, or incite a war between China and England so they can craft the perfect headlines and maximize profits, or steal an entire country's water supply and install a dictatorship while pretending to be for the environment and against corruption. It's another example of how Wood and Gilbert refined an idea they started with in The Spy Who Loved Me. Where Stromberg is driven by his ideology to create a new world under the sea, it gets obfuscated during the film, a product of rewrites, by scenes where Stromberg seems laser-focused on finances. In Moonraker, on the other hand, it's more deliberate. Drax's motivation based on ideology is never clouded in the script. He doesn't stand to gain any kind of wealth from his schemes. The only reason he ever acquired wealth to begin with was to facilitate his plans. I'm wealthy and have pulled my resources in order to create a master race. It makes Drax unlike most other Bond villains, even the ones later on that were inspired by him, and it justifies a lot of the disdain that Bond comes to have for him, culminating in Bond not only killing Drax, but overkilling him. Drax is dead the second Bond shoots him with the poisonous dart, proceeding to eject Drax into open space. Is just spiteful, but it is so earned. The circumstances in which Bond finds himself contending with the force of power that is Drax also began something of a recurring trend for the series, Bond going rogue. The only time we had really seen this before was in Honor Majesty's Secret Service, where Bond attempts early on to resign from MI6 due to a fundamental disconnect with M. Thankfully, that was shut down by Moneypenny, and later engages in an operation with Mark and Draco to rescue Tracy and take down Blofeld and his scheme. But otherwise, spends most of the film operating within the purview of M's wishes, and even the cinematic raid on P's Gloria is ultimately something that benefits MI6 and doesn't seem to earn Bond any particular scorn from M. In Moonraker, on the other hand, Bond truly finds himself at odds with MI6 because of Drax's aforementioned relationships with his superiors, to the point where his accusations against Drax are scoffed at, and when his efforts to expose Drax's schemes are foiled, Drax using his immense resources to completely remove an intricate chemical laboratory overnight, he's more or less placed on notice by Frederick Grey for both wasting the department's time and harassing Drax. If it weren't for M, with Bernard Lee forming a dynamic with Bond specifically in Moonraker that is similar to Bond and Mallory's dynamic, giving Bond one last chance out of loyalty, Drax would likely have gone on to destroy the world. Bond would later go rogue to accomplish his goals in films like License to Kill and Spectre, but the Bond film that most parallels Moonraker in this respect, with Bond earning the ire of government officials, is Quantum of Solace, which goes an extra step further and finds Bond framed for murder while instigating a powerful organization, with a manhunt initiated for the decorated MI6 agent as a result. Meanwhile, we get a deeper look at the machinations and connections of the main villain, with Dominic Green utilizing a relationship with the CIA to increase the pressure on Bond. Once again, Moonraker draws a direct throughline to one of the darker, more serious films in this series. What was that you were saying about a goofy camp romp that's absolutely stupid? Oh yeah, right. Back when You Only Live Twice was made, Eon and Lewis Gilbert had carte blanche to use Spectre and Blofeld however they pleased. By the time Moonraker arrived, however, the fiasco with Kevin McClory had come and gone, and the Bond films could no longer use Spectre as a villain. One of the most brilliant choices made with Drax was to be the exact opposite of Blofeld. Instead of a mustache-twirling criminal holding the world at ransom, Drax is an authoritarian driven by fascist ideologies. The reason this character swap is so inspired is because just as Eon had lost the rights to Spectre, the politics of the real world had also ended Spectre's ability to resonate with audiences on screen. It's not that the faceless money-making conglomerate ceased to exist, there will always be people pulling the strings behind the scenes in our society, so much as the world began to see villains that weren't afraid to show their face. Henry Kissinger and the Koch brothers, for example, might not have built space stations from which they could stage genocide, but they weren't afraid to support and even bankroll military campaigns like Vietnam or Desert Storm, operations intended to increase the US's stranglehold on the rest of the world. Drax's scheme to annihilate humanity, save for his perfect specimens, therefore operates as a miniature of this idea, a master race at the expense of the rest of humankind, versus US dominance at the expense of entire regions of our globe. And so, if you're Hugo Drax, why hire or be involved in any way with Spectre when you can just fund and execute your plans yourself and become ruler of mankind? Not having Spectre at their disposal forced Eon to tap into the socio-political changes of the era, in the process creating a commentary that felt far more potent and relevant than most other times that the Bond series had tried to comment on political crises of the day. Drax, like Bond, serves to keep Moonraker grounded, even when it becomes most absurd. You think the space station and the fact that Bond is aboard it is ridiculous? Well, allow me to interrupt that thought with Drax's speech on how he plans to eradicate humanity and replace it with his perfect specimen. It's horrifying. The parallels to fascism are right there on the surface. But the master race in space aside, Moonraker executes its balancing act between absurdity and playing it straight when on Earth as well. I mean, there's even a scene here where Drax calls a fucking henchman hotline in order to hire Jaws. It's like a moment out of Austin Powers done 20 years before and in an actual Bond film. And yet, despite how ridiculous and self-parodying the moment is, it works. Michael Lonsdale, by playing it completely straight, actually dials down the absurdity to the point where you almost don't realize how ridiculous it is that Bond villains have a hotline they can call in order to hire 7-foot-tall men with steel teeth. Moonraker on paper seems like it should be a total product of its time, a campy space-surfing abomination that was just following a trend. And yet, in execution, Moonraker is actually better and has aged better in retrospect, maybe with the exception of the gondola chase, which kind of grinds the film to a halt for a couple minutes. The plot is always propelling itself forward, often using its action to do so. If any action scene, like the cable car fight, can't do that, then the film gets it out of the way fairly quickly and never lets it grow tedious. In addition, because of the film's pace, combined with the way it gradually grows more absurd until it crescendos with the space station, enables the viewer to be eased into the preposterousness rather than just thrust into it. Moonraker knows what it is, but more importantly, it knew what the cinematic landscape surrounding it looked like. Spielberg and Lucas were the biggest names at the box office, sci-fi was the big trendy genre, and as the Bond franchise seems to always ask, how can it fit into the current landscape? Moonraker understands the fun, adventurous, wondrous escapism of Star Wars, of Close Encounters of the Third Kind, both films that came out in 1977, and at least at the box office, pretty much left the year's Bond entry, The Spy Who Loved Me, in the spacefaring dust when you compare the latter film to either of the former ones. The choice to pivot towards sci-fi was made almost instantaneously and more or less unanimously among the decision makers at Eon Productions after Star Wars cleaned house. Hell, they even went into talks with Steven Spielberg early in pre-production for him to direct the film. Eon quickly went in a different direction though, because having Spielberg direct the film would have undermined the very reason he was approached, to have Bond get to where Spielberg is blockbuster-wise, not have Spielberg eclipse Bond by making what would have almost certainly been the biggest film in the series. But in the process of following the leader, Moonraker manages to do its own thing with sci-fi. It isn't just made fun of because of its more ridiculous moments, though it certainly revels in those, because it really does play into the spectacle of sci-fi and Bond in a new way. Lewis Gilbert knew what he was doing when he chose to set Drax's hidden Aztec lair in the temples of Tikal in Guatemala, the same temples that were used to portray Yavin 4 in Star Wars. Hell, fast forward to the climax of the film and Bond destroying the last of Drax's poison-spewing globes just flat out steals the ending of Star Wars as well, right down to Bond having to turn off his targeting computer. These are clear homages, and Moonraker isn't even trying to hide it, but it's also announcing that Bond films can take this direction without compromising their integrity as well. It's kind of ironic then that Moonraker so often gets cast aside because it's just doing Star Wars, considering it created a shorthand in cinema. X went to space, X is the Moonraker of the franchise. Mission Impossible is going to space. The Fast and Furious franchise went to space. F9 is the Moonraker of the Fast and Furious franchise. Honestly, the reason Moonraker works, and the reason so many other films that attempt to do what it did fail, I'm looking at you, F9, is because it isn't part of the joke. They try to mock the grandiosity they cling to, and therefore, we as an audience can't take things seriously, and so the film loses all of its stakes. Whereas Moonraker doesn't spend half of its runtime pointing out the insane things that are going on. It trusts the viewer to comprehend the scope and scale and balances that with real moments of gravity, character beats, intimate moments, actual tension and concern for Bond's safety, where the threat he faces off against feels real, feels like it could succeed, where the film aspires to do more than just feature cartoon characters in a cartoon world doing cartoon things. Bond going to space is always going to be some level of silly no matter how you spin it. Jaws being hired from a hitman hotline and then falling in love, while a sweet character moment, is a little silly. But Bond and Drax are never silly. Like I said before, Goodhead, her name aside, is far less silly and far more human than most of the Bond women who came before her. Real moments of gravity are needed in order to keep the thing earthed. Even within the Bond franchise itself, chasing after Moonraker's accomplishments with an imperfect understanding of why Moonraker works resulted in a near catastrophe during the Brosnan era. After Dalton and the 6-year hiatus, Eon went through a similar succession of films that started with GoldenEye, a post-Cold War thriller that still had one foot in the Dalton era, continued on with Tomorrow Never Dies and The World Is Not Enough, which both reintroduced villains hell-bent on creating chaos for profit, and then, just as it seemed like the series was on the cusp of a Moonraker for a new generation, Eon wildly overshot into pure insanity with Die Another Day. If the film and the characters don't take the story seriously, why should we? For Moonraker, there's no pretense. Lewis Gilbert makes his Star Wars response and calls it a day. And he does it all within the final hour of what is otherwise a mostly standard globetrotting Bond adventure. That's similar to how another film inspired by Moonraker and even featuring footage from Moonraker in it lovingly made its tribute to Moonraker and even borrowed from its story without pretending it was doing anything else. And so it was much more successful than other Moonraker homages, Black Widow. I'm going to be bold and say that to date, Black Widow is the film that wears Moonraker's influence most prominently on its sleeve. The climax takes place on a flying sky base miles up in the air, which is scientifically speaking a literal world away from a space station, but dramatically feels as distant from the ground. How do our heroes get there? They get captured the same way as how Holly Goodhead and later Bond do after breaking out. The only difference being that the Black Widow team break out after they arrive on the station, whereas Bond and Goodhead escape and then commandeer a shuttle to get to Drax's space station. In the process of confronting the film's main villain, they also destroy the flying base, sending it crashing down to Earth, while also rescuing the henchmen, while the henchman has a change of heart. The day is saved, our heroes live, the villain perishes, and the US government even swoops in at the last moment after most and all of the work has basically been done by the heroes anyway. It feels almost cheap to make this argument to point out these parallels, because Black Widow pretty much signals it for us earlier in the film, when Natasha is kicking back and watching Moonraker, you almost have to wonder if in-universe, her love of the film, she's quoting it as it plays along, meaning she's watched it at least a few times before, subconsciously informs her actions during the climax. If that doesn't have you convinced, then think about the bigger picture of Black Widow, and overall the structure of the film. Like Moonraker, it starts from the ground level and constantly ramps itself up and gets bigger and bigger as the film gets closer to the flying base, but while doing so, it largely allows Scarlett Johansson to play things straight even when David Harbour is quipping into her ear. In any case, if above all else, the freaking Marvel Cinematic Universe directly lifting from Moonraker, and proudly so at that, isn't a testament to the fact that Moonraker is an influential Bond film, then for the last time, I don't know what is. By the time a decade had passed since Moonraker sent Bond to space, it seemed like Bond was back down to Earth for good. But now, it's 2021, and Moonraker, like so many other Bond films that experience a run as the black sheep, the afterthought, the one we don't talk about, has seen a resurgence in popularity, its defenders coming out of hiding and singing its praises. I'm definitely not complaining about this, but I can't help but wonder why. Why now? Well, there's a real-world parallel between when Moonraker came out and where we are today. Things kind of suck. The 70s were the decade where Saigon fell, where we were still reeling from JFK, MLK, RFK, where MASH and All in the Family, the biggest shows on television, shamelessly riffed on the position society was in thanks to the Greatest Generation. An energy crisis threatened automobiles, an impeached president resigned the office, and in 1979, the year Moonraker was released, divorce rates in the United States peaked. Compare that to today, where we've just withdrawn from another 20-year stalemate, where we impeached the president twice, where our environment is falling apart, gun violence is out of control, and 9/11 happened, and a lot of stuff never got better after that. I bet listening to me rattle off all of that was uncomfortable. That's exactly my point. People need an escape from all of that. People need to be able to find a way to laugh, to have fun, and to get away from the world. Movies can do that in general, but Moonraker took it as literally as possible. And I think audiences latched onto that just like they did with Star Wars and Close Encounters. Even on the best days, sci-fi can endlessly captivate and inspire. We can just shut off the world for a moment and go somewhere else. It takes a special kind of film to accomplish that while in its initial box office run. It takes something beyond explanation to be able to accomplish the same more than 40 years after the fact. In some ways, Moonraker accomplishes this because it strains the Bond franchise almost to the breaking point. It's the pinnacle of Bond balancing the proper dosage of absurdity among a rock-solid foundation of both engaging espionage and down-to-earth characterization. If you stay true to the character of James Bond, you probably have some level of success on your hands. Moonraker achieves this in the way that it doesn't make Bond silly. It doesn't make Bond the joke. Rather, it plays out the joke while Bond is something of an observer to it. On the opposite extreme end of the spectrum, License to Kill shows the character at his darkest and angriest, in a film that is arguably still the series' most violent. but it succeeds because it never forgets how to have a bit of fun and relieve the tension with humor when necessary. If you don't make the distinction either way, though, the whole thing collapses into itself, and that's how you end up with something like Die Another Day. This is the influence of Moonraker, often imitated on a superficial level, but usually missing a couple of necessary ingredients. Give it another shot. Pop it in. Take it for what it is. Have a good time with it, and see if you feel any differently about it afterwards. At the very least, I hope the thing it gets most underappreciated for, its influence and impact on the Bond franchise, and on action cinema in its own right, gets a little bit more notice as the film itself has in recent years.